Okay, so I'm going to explain the life of a packet in LISP. Okay, so we have the ID space, we have two hosts, host A and host B, which both of them, they have one EID, EID A and EID B. And then we have two tunnel routers, two LISP routers. One has airlock 1, and the other one has two connections with the internet, airlock B1 and airlock B2. Okay, and now I'm going to explain how a packet goes from host A to host B. Okay, so first of all, as it happens today, the internet, host A will ask to the DNS, okay, please tell me which is the IP address of host B. And the DNS will reply with an IP address, which in this case we will assume or will interpret that it is an EID. So it will reply with EID B. And then host A will forward the packet as it happens today. So in LISP, you don't require any change on the host. Okay, host remain as we have today. So host A will forward the packet, and the packet is a standard IP packet. So it will have as the source address, the EID of host A, as the destination address, the EID of host B, plus the content, which is the data from the application. And this is the IP header. Okay. So whenever the packet reaches the tunnel router, the tunnel router does not know where actually EID B is. Actually, recall that you cannot forward EID packets on the airlock space. So you need to map it. You need to know which is the locator for EID B. So it will send a message to the mapping system. Again, very similar to the DNS, which is called a map request. And it will ask the mapping system, could you please tell me where is actually EID B? Well, the message will be forwarded through the mapping system until it reaches this tunnel router, which will reply with two airlocks. Okay. If you want to reach EID B, you can send packets to either airlock B1 or airlock B2. And on top of that, it will state which is the policy. The traffic engineering policies, which is, okay, in this case, I have two links, both of them, they have the same priority, and I want 50% of the traffic on one link and 50% of the traffic on the other link. As you can imagine, you can have different priorities, many links, or different weights for each link. So you can implement load balancing, active backup policies, or whatever you want. Okay, so once the XTR, this tunnel router, knows where it has to send the packet so that it reaches host B, it will encapsulate the packet, and it will forward the packet to, in this case, airlock B1. Okay, so how does the encapsulated packet look like? Okay, here we have the original packet, which is again source address EID A, destination address EID B, plus the content. Then you prepend a LISP header, which is a header which is it has some flags and some reachability information. And then you UDP encapsulate the packet actually. So you add a UDP header plus another IP header with the source address airlock A1, which is this router, and destination address airlock B1, which is this router, and actually this interface. So the packet will be forwarded through the airlock space, which is the core of the internet, only based on this header. So you don't need to change anything on the core of the internet. They will forward packet as it is happening today, okay, based on the destination address, which is B1. Eventually, the packet will reach the tunnel router. And what the router will do is decapsulate it. So it will strip all these headers and will only leave the packet, the original packet, which again has source address EID A, destination address EID B plus the data. And finally, the packet will reach the destination. So this is pretty much how LISP works. Now, how does a LISP packet look like, which is what we were discussing before? Okay, LISP packets are using UDP encapsulation, destination port 4341. Why UDP? Because it works very well with firewalls, and it is a connectionless protocol. Also, it has a zero checksum, so you don't need to compute the UDP header checksum. Why? Because you have already many checksums on the IP addresses, on the IP headers, excuse me, on the TCP headers, if the data packet is using it to protect the packet. This is how the LISP header looks like, and it contains reachability information, which are all these flags. It also contains something which is called the instance ID, which is a 24-bit field which can be used for isolating or for virtual routers, VLANs, this kind of application. And then, how does the router look like? Okay, the tunnel router does not request a mapping for each packet. Whenever it learns a mapping, for instance through this map reply, as we have seen before, what it will do is store this mapping in a cache. So packets which are addressed towards the same AD, they don't have to send a map request. The information is already cached on what to do. This map cache, which is called map cache, is equivalent to the RIP in BGP. So it is the information that LISP routers use to forward packets. So basically it has PID to airlock bindings. They operate based on the longest prefix match, as any RIP. Typically, they implement least recently used policy, which is a very common policy for any kind of cache. And it also includes a time to live. So each mapping includes a time to live, so that the mapping has to be expired. The tunnel router has to expire the mapping whenever the time to live expires, and it has to be refreshed, so it has to send another map request. Okay, then what about the control plane? What about the mapping system? Well, as I was saying, the mapping system is a distributed database that supports records. Okay. That supports these mappings. So first I'm going to explain how these mappings work, then I'm going to explain which is the interface to the mapping system, and finally I'm going to explain a little bit, very very briefly, how the mapping system works. So this is actually a LISP mapping, okay? So this is actually the message that contains EID to airlock bindings. Okay, as I was saying, the most important fields are the TTL, so that this mapping has only a certain amount of time where it can be used, otherwise it has to be expired. Then it includes the EID prefix, and then the set of locators. Okay, this is the set of locators where that actually bind to this EID. Then for each locator, you can specify the priority and the weight. This is for traffic engineering purposes. And finally, you have the locator, which is the IP address of the router. So how this traffic engineering works? So as I was saying before, each mapping contains priorities and weights. So for instance, you can stating 150 means that both locators have the same priority, and that you want half of the traffic into one locator and half of the traffic into another locator. So this means basically load balancing. Or you can define 100, 2 to 100, which means that you have an active link, which is this one, but if this link fails, then please use the second one, a backup link, which is again a very common policy in ISPs, in networks. It is also worth noting that LISP does not only support EID IP addresses. By means of the LISP canonical address identifier format, it supports many other kind of formats. You don't need only, you can map other things, not only IP address to IP addresses, but you can map, for instance, MAC addresses to IP addresses. This is, for instance, relevant for layer 2 VPNs. And this is the mapping system interface. So the mapping system supports the following message. So the first message is map register, which is used by tunnel routers to register a mapping. So whenever they want to register a mapping, they send the map register to the mapping system. Then the map notify message is used by the mapping system to notify a tunnel router that a mapping has been registered successfully. And then you have two more messages, which is map request, which is used to request a mapping to the mapping system, and you have the map reply, which is used to actually send a mapping to a tunnel router. The map reply is not sent by the mapping system, because the mapping system actually forwards the map request to the tunnel router, which is responsible for that mapping, which in turn will send the map reply to the requester. Okay, so this is which are the messages. And I'm going to skip how the mapping system works. You can read the slides and follow the slides. Also consider the documents that are cited I think that all of them, they are pretty self-contained. Okay, so here you have how the mapping system works with all the details. Then in the slides, we also have information about internet working. So how does a LISP site interoperate with a non-LISP site? And this is used by means of proxy ITRs and proxy ETRs. There are also some details about how you actually manage the map cache, because at the end the cache needs consistency. What happens when a tunnel router changes a mapping? For instance, it has a new airlock or one airlock goes down, so it has to inform its peers about this, and this is done by means of a message which is called solicit map request, which forces the tunnel router to refresh the mapping. Then there are also some details about airlock reachability, which is used what happens when there is a failure on the path. Okay, so how those two routers understand that there has been a failure on the path and that they have to follow a different path. And here is the bibliography where you can check many documents that describe all the details about this. So thank you.